I don't like the railroad men. No, I don't. I don't like the railroad man. Cause railroad man, he'll shoot you if he can. And drink down your blood like wine. I was 9 when I learned that song. Oh, I wish I was old. Come on, sing it for my dad.
You know, when we start with Sunday Assembly, and this is just going to be fantastic because we're going to start off with Paul and Dan.
Woo!
I just think all of us can handle it. This thing.
Sunday Assembly is a secular, non-religious community. We meet monthly to hear great talks, to connect with community events, to have some snacks, to sing some songs, but mostly, we are here to celebrate this one life that we're living. The motto for Sunday Assembly is live better, help often, and wonder more. And we have so many opportunities for you to do that. And there's other things that I'm supposed to say here, so I'm going to say them. If this is your first time in assembly, if you wouldn't mind, just please raise your hand and keep it up just for a moment. So give those people a high five. I'm so glad to have you here. This is a really wonderful, welcoming community. Well, we have a thing called Life Happens, and that's where we share a little bit of the things that are going on in our life. So we have just a bunch of them today, so I'm going to read it. This is from Lynn Warner. For the last few months, she's returned to her old pleasure, which is buying and selling Legos and Duplos on eBay. So if you have a Milano cookie snack today, please save the plastic packaging for me. It is the perfect size for storing tiny Lego pieces in. That's the inside of a Milano cookie, just so you know. So please do that. Thank you, Lynn. Just a side note on this. I've been in Lynn's living room. There's Legos everywhere when she's in the middle of this, so she really needs these.
Yeah, don't walk barefoot.
Let's talk a little bit about the things that Sunday Assembly is helping you help out in the community. So I'm going to bring up our community chair, Ms. Jen McCown, and I'm going to stall here for a little bit while she makes that ambulation all the way over to this place where you can talk and be heard. Jen?
Good morning. So last weekend, we had a group of people do a cleanup at South Shores, our adopted beach on Mission Bay, and we picked up around 25 pounds of trash in 2 hours from the coastline. So, great job. Thank you. Next weekend, we will be serving dinner at the Salon Tepeyac Migrant Shelter in Sherman Heights. If you're interested in participating in that, see me after assembly, or you can email Valerie Norton. Her email is in the program. Thank you.
Thank you, Jen. I don't know why I'm walking back over to the microphone. I don't need to. We have a couple of readings today, and these are really terrific. Portable Paradise by Roger Robinson and Coconut by Paul Hotvatsky. If I can trouble the Portable Paradise person to come up. That would be Lou, our Portable Paradise person.
Thanks for welcoming me up. The Portable Paradise by Roger Robinson. And if I speak of paradise, then I'm speaking of my grandmother, who told me to carry it always on my person, concealed, so no one else would know but me. That way they can't steal it, she'd say. And if life puts you under pressure, trace its ridges in your pocket, smell its piney scent on your handkerchief, hum its anthem under your breath. And if your stresses are sustained and daily, get yourself to an empty room, be it hotel, hostel, or hovel. Find a lamp and empty your paradise onto a desk. Your white sands, green hills, and fresh fish. Shine the lamp on it like a fresh hope of morning, and keep staring at it till you sleep.
Charles, they say when you recite a poem, it should sound like you're reading it for the first time. That will not be a challenge at this point. This is Coconut by Paul Hostovsky. Bear with me. I want to tell you something about happiness. It's hard to get at. But the thing is, I wasn't looking. I was looking somewhere else when my son found it in the fruit section and came running, holding it out in his small hands, asking me what it was and could we keep it. It only cost 99 cents, hairy and brown, hard as a rock, and something swishing around inside. And what on earth and where on earth was this happiness? This little ball of interest beating inside his chest, this interestedness beaming out from his face, pleading happiness. And because I wasn't happy, I said to put it back, because I didn't want it, because we didn't need it. And because he was happy, he started to cry right there in aisle 5. So when we got home, we put it in the middle of the kitchen table and sat on either side of it and began to consider how to get inside of it.
That was excellent. Our speaker today, Joscelyn Inton-Campbell, pronouns she, they, is the youth program manager for the TransFamily Support Services and a lecturer at CSU San Marcos in women's gender and sexuality studies. Her scholarly work has explored the transing of peace and conflict studies, public mental health research for LGBTQ plus community needs, and restorative justice from a queer perspective. Day to day, they work to nurture community spaces and provide services to help trans youth survive and thrive in an ever increasingly hostile world. She's a humanist, a non-binary trans woman, and a bi-lesbian among many other identities. Please welcome to Sunday Assembly, Joscelyn Campbell.
Hello. I wasn't sure quite when I would be going on, so I'm like,
oh, okay.
Now, myself here. All right. Give me one moment so I can get a clock in front of me so that I actually try to stay within time a little bit. So today I'm going to be talking about gender euphoria and a little bit of a short history of gender. But before I jump into all of that, just a little bit about who I am. Joscelyn Inton-Campbell, she, they. Gracie already did a wonderful introduction for me, so you already have some basics. But if you go to the next slide, I do want to highlight TransFamily Support Services, where I work as a youth program manager, working with trans and gender diverse youth. And we support trans and gender diverse youth of all ages, their families, their communities. We provide training and education, online and in-person events, all sorts of things. If you want more info, I have a bunch of flyers back there on the table. But I'm going to just keep on going. Okay. So what's gender? Anyone have any answers? Okay. Probably have a few thoughts pop in your head. Maybe you think of biology. You know, that's something that we hear a lot, is the idea of biological sex or gender. Maybe you think of material conditions, gender as a class structure. Maybe you think of a social role and expectations. Maybe identity. How we express ourselves. Or maybe if you're really nerdy, you think about gender performance and Judith Butler. Well, we're gonna try to answer this question a little bit, but just to kind of give us some frameworks to start with as a baseline. First up is the SOGSC. This is used a lot in activism and human rights circles. Basically, it's just these categories which everyone has. These things. Everyone has a sexual orientation. That's who you want to be with sexually or romantically. Everyone has a gender identity. Who are you? Man, woman, non-binary, something else, all of them, none of them. Gender expression. How do you present yourself to the world? How do you dress? How do you talk? And sex characteristics. These are physical aspects of the body. And it goes beyond just male or female. There are intersex characteristics as well, where some people have ones that don't align with our expectations of just male or female. These are things that everyone has. And this is kind of a good place to start when we're thinking about transness, gender, and all of these things. So, next up, some other terms that I want to make sure we're all on the same page on. Transgender, you've probably heard this one before, basically having a gender identity that's different than what you were assigned at birth. Cisgender is having a gender identity that's the same as the one assigned at birth. So if you're assigned male at birth and you identify as a man, you're a cisgender man. If you're assigned male at birth and you identify as a woman, you're a trans woman. Pretty simple, just adjectives. Gender diversity. This is an inclusive term that I often use that is a wide range of variations in gender. Basically, we often say trans and gender diverse to kind of capture everybody in the gender non-conforming umbrella. And non-binary, of course, is someone who does not align with the gender binary. That raises the question, what's the gender binary? Okay, so what is the gender binary? Any answers? Okay, I guess that's why I'm here to talk today. So, a lot of times with gender binary, it's both an idea and a system. it starts from this idea that there is male and female, and these two things are completely separate, distinct, opposite, and mutually exclusive. That basically, if you are one, you can't be the other, and so on and so forth. This often also means the characteristics we attribute are different. So men wear pants, women wear dresses. That would be a gender binary, that these are two distinct things. And while many people don't necessarily abide by that anymore, we still have it on our bathroom signs everywhere, right? So that's the basic idea. And it's a system by which we organize our society. When you're born, people look at your body and assign you into one box or the other. And if you're born intersex, in a lot of places, they will surgically change your body to match it without consent. So the gender binary is a coercive system we all live. Okay, so this is how the gender binary presents things. I think most people, though, if you go to the next slide, probably have at least some sense, maybe it's like this. Maybe it's a spectrum with masculine and man on one side, feminine and woman on the other side, and maybe there's people in the middle or in different places or that move back and forth, like gender fluid. But I'm gonna argue it's actually more than that. So the next slide, it's more like this. It's this big wibbly-wobbly thing with all these different possibilities. There's many femininities, many masculinities. You know, think of the difference between, in media, I love Doctor Who. The Doctor is this caring, nurturing person who is non-violent, and then you have, like, James Bond. Both of these are masculine characters, but completely different forms of masculinity. And then, you know, I toss in yellow there at the edge because there's also people that don't identify anywhere on that spectrum and whose expression and experience doesn't map onto it. So this is kind of where I want us to start with our thinking about gender. That's this big thing, but we try to shove it into these small boxes, these tiny little areas on that big map. Okay, so this brings us to the actual content. So I threw a bunch at you. Sorry if that was a lot for a gender 101, but we're going to do a little short history of gender dysphoria. Now, some people know this term as it relates to transgender people. This is the idea that often in medical contexts, that if your gender identity does not align with your assigned gender at birth, you experience distress, and that we want to do things either physical or social to address that and reduce that distress. It has a history, though, that's very particular. I want to go back, 600 years or so, just a quick jaunt into the past. Before the age of colonialism and colonization, when Europe spread out and colonized the world, there was a lot of different genders in the world. Everywhere you went, every culture, every continent, there were more than two generally. And gender was a lot more about what you did most of the time. It was how you lived in the world, the roles you played in your culture, your society. I often use the example from my wife's scholarship. In Filipino culture, they have four genders. Girl, boy, bakla, and tomboy. The idea being that the bakla, for example, is a feminine-souled, some feminine-spirited, male-bodied person. So this can both mean feminine gay men, or it could mean trans women. This is how they understand it. And it's kind of seen as just a natural part of how humans are. When you go way back into the past, these people often played specific roles in the society that were spiritual and were places of authority. Well, when the Spanish started showing up in North America and South America and Asia, they were like, well, the church is our authority and we can't have someone competing with us. So if there's a different spiritual authority, we have to crush that. This is where the genocide of indigenous gender diversity begins. One of the ways that they justified eliminating many of these cultures was by pointing out, oh, there's these divergent, perverse identities. They started criminalizing sexual and gender diversity by criminalizing sodomy and cross-dressing, specific acts, not identities. In fact, I often think here in San Diego, we have Balboa Park. These conquistador de Balboa that it's named after, famously, there's a woodcut painting of him feeding, like, I think it's like 20 different gender diverse people to rabid dogs to murder them because they were guilty of sodomy and cross dressing. So this process begins and it gets more and more severe. The French, the English, the Portuguese, they all adopt similar stances and they make these criminal acts to justify the elimination of these other sources of power or ways of being. This is where we get the gender binary, and it's very much linked to the history of eugenics. If you're familiar with the history of eugenics, that's the idea that we can breed people like dogs, and that there are traits we want to cultivate, and often it means there are certain races that are considered better, and you want to cultivate their qualities. So the gender binary is with that because Europeans looked out at the world, and when they looked at, say, East Asia, men didn't have as facial hair as often, and women didn't have facial hair. Well, that's why Europeans are better, you see, because men have facial hair, women don't. So therefore, facial hair is something that's different that makes us superior. They did those kinds of things where they tied sexual differentiation and gender differentiation, which also meant things like feminine people are submissive and nurturing, and men are aggressive and violent. And they tied those in as markers that they wanted to cultivate. So the gender binary and racism and eugenics were linked from the very beginning. This was established in our society through laws, practices, and it spread throughout everything. So, next slide, yes. When we get to the 19th century, we start to see this turn into a pathology, a disease. They call it sexual inversion. There's a book called Psychopathia Sexualis by Kraft Ebbing that kind of coins some of the first terms like homosexual, heterosexual. It coins terms like transvestism. And these were seen as mental illnesses. And it was basically, you are divergent from this system we have, you are criminal, and therefore, we're gonna say that you can be treated and rehabilitated. Okay, so that's better than just murdering us, I will say that. But not that much better. Conversion therapy, not great. So this is where the idea of transvestism first comes as a term. You've probably heard transvestite. Just means to wear clothes across your gender identity. And in that case, it is inclusive of not just trans people as we understand them today, but also just people who dressed in gender non-conforming ways. Any woman here who's wearing pants today, welcome, you're a transvestite now. At least according to a 19th century person. Transsexualism emerges a little further on as a more refined version of this, where it's people who want their bodies to, their relationship to their body is different, and they want to embody a different gender or sex. And transsexualism is still considered a mental illness, one that can be treated through physical care, which again, bigger improvement. So we've gone from murdering us, locking us in asylums, and now, okay, maybe some of us can get medical care while some of us go to jail. Gender identity disorder is the more politically correct version that the Diagnostic and Statistic Manual of the APA starts using later on. And when we get to the 20th century, there's a shift that starts to happen, especially in the 80s and 90s, in trans communities. We start pushing back and we say, you know, we are not sick for being who we are. We just are who we are. Let us be. Let us exist. This is a good example of this, where the idea of transgender emerges, where it's an inclusive term that captures people who don't fit in the gender binary, people who cross it or violate it or just don't really align with it in some way. And transgender liberation, a movement whose time has come, is a pamphlet by Leslie Feinberg that articulates this idea of transgender as literally all of those people that cross or violate the gender binary. This included everybody from butch lesbians to trans women and men to genderqueer, non-binary people. They don't really map onto any of that. This was something that was really caught on in activist circles. It motivated people, and it started changing the way we thought about things. Because up until now, the normal, the default, is considered cisgender. It's to be the gender you're assigned at birth. And us trans folks are divergent. Now we're going, wait, we're just another kind of person. We're just part of the natural diversity. So if we don't center that, if we center trans people instead, and how we talk about trans people, maybe we start thinking about things differently. So that leads into the next period, yes. We get the push for depathologization. One of the ways this shows up in the US is updating the diagnoses and the gender, or in the diagnostic and statistic manual, the DSM, to where, it's now called gender dysphoria. And according to the World Health Organization guidelines, gender incongruence, these terms are not actually disorders or mental illnesses. They merely describe distress, discomfort, something not being the way you want to be. And they're still kind of based on this idea of a misalignment between identity and body, identity and social roles. So it still has this history carried in it. It still has some of this pathologization pathway in it. But it's definitely an improvement. So now we've gone from only some of us get care and we have to abide by gender binary rules still and all this other stuff to like, okay, we can be a little bit different. We can be ourselves. We can get care. A lot of people want to make this illegal, but you know, it is something where things have improved. Now, in my circles, we've been talking more and more about maybe shifting this even further and understanding gender dysphoria as a little different, as a matter of gender trauma. And by that, I mean that when I was a little girl, who was seen as a little boy, I was told I couldn't express myself, embody myself, be myself in so many ways. And think about when you were a little kid, 4 or 5, and something core to who you are is something you cannot let the people around you know. Let not let the adults that you rely on to survive know. You never feel safe. This is complex trauma. This is PTSD. I've literally been diagnosed and gone to therapy for it. And so this is something where like a lot of these experiences of gender distress and gender dysphoria are often coming from these traumatic experiences of forcing us into these small little boxes where we don't really belong. So another way of thinking about things that I rather prefer, because this is focusing on what's bad, negative, how we suffer. What I prefer is thinking about gender euphoria. This is how I figured out I was trans. When I was, 6, 7 years ago now, before I figured things out, I was like, no, I'm a cisgender heterosexual man. Yes, yes, absolutely. Yeah, I just, you know, it would be really nice to wake up as a girl someday. I don't mind being a man, but oh gosh, it would be really nice to be a woman, huh? And that is really pointing at this idea of gender euphoria, where you feel aligned, whole, joyous, full in your life. And I think gender euphoria is something that applies to all of us. It's something that's not just about trans people. All of us want to feel good and affirmed in who we are. We want to feel aligned with who we are. You know, I think of simple things like, I know tons of cisgender guys who are afraid of wearing bright colors. Because when we were kids, we got made fun of or bullied for wearing the color pink or yellow. Instead, when you go to the men's clothing section, it's like blue, green, gray. Oh, sorry, I'm calling a few of you out. But no, it is something where maybe we want to have other ways to express ourselves. But these boxes we've been shoved in have made it hard even for cisgender people and non-trans people. For trans folks, it can often be a revelation that, wait, if I would feel better and happier and more whole in myself, I can transition. I don't just have to hate myself. That opens up doors. And so this is why I like to focus on gender euphoria. And if you want to go to the next slide, just to kind of emphasize this, one of the things that I like to point to is gender dysphoria for me, personally, is an experience of disconnection, misalignment, incompleteness, or distress. It's something where something's just not fitting right. I often tell people that before transition, it was like I was trying to live my whole life with only 30% of myself. You can't live 100% of a life with only 30% of yourself. Gender euphoria is what helped connect me to my body, put me in my body, aligned me with how I feel in my body, but also how I present myself and dress, how I relate to other people, how I embody myself in the world. It's what made me feel whole and joyful. It made me go from being a chronically depressed cis guy to, well, still chronically depressed, but much less so, and actually loving my life, actually wanting to be alive for myself. And that is so powerful. And that's part of why I do my work with TransFamily Support Services, to bring it back around, is to help young people find gender euphoria, wherever they're coming from. They don't have to be trans or gender diverse already. They can be questioning or just not certain or just be friends. And the key is helping people feel free to explore and find themselves and live as themselves in this world. And I hope maybe you all can leave today thinking about how you can embody yourselves and live a full, happy life. It's Father's Day, maybe think of how you can help your father feel, you know, affirmed and euphoric in being a man today. There's lots of ways to do that. You know, put him out by the grill and give him a car, I don't know. But, you know, find those things that help a person feel affirmed and joyous in themselves. And it's okay to do that. So, if you all want to ask questions or you have thoughts afterwards bubbling in your heads, feel free to come to talk to me afterwards. And with that, I will pass it back to Bruce.
Good idea.
Thank you for your talk. That was really hit home for me, and it had a lot of lots to think about. And I liked it all except for the guys wearing blue, green, and gray. I'm all with you. Thanks for those poems, selecting those. I love both of those poems. They're so great. They're so great for today. And they're Lou and Charles. Thank you so much for your wonderful reading. Well, for my MC address today, I'd like to talk about my own gender dysphoria. I'd like to talk about the names we call each other. And I'd like to talk about something that's really been bothering me that I think I've found a way to work around.
But we'll have a song first.
But let's do a song first, shall we? I just wanted to bump it and prime it. So you'd be excited to hear
about Paula Dan!
I apologize for sitting and having knee surgery next month, and my knee's killing me today, so I shall sit, which is unheard of for me. Well, let's sing this beautiful song.
Lying in my bed, I hear the clock tick and think of you, caught up in circles. Confusion is nothing new. We got a black back, four nights, almost left behind. Suitcase of memories, time after sometimes you picture me. I'm walking too far ahead. You're calling to me. I can't hear what you have said. Then you say, go slow. I fall behind. The second hand unwinds. If you're lost, you can look and you will find me. Time after time, if you
So, asterisk, insert. The things I'm going to be talking about today, I'm going to be talking out of my own experience, and these are my own thoughts and ideas. So, I'm not speaking for anyone else. Certainly not all the trans people in the world. So today is Father's Day. Now, Father's Day and Sunday Assembly are no strangers because Father's Day always occurs on the third Sunday of the month. Father's Day started in 1909 when a woman named Sonora Dodd in Spokane, Washington, got inspired by listening to a sermon about Mother's Day, which is then becoming a recognized holiday, and she came up with the idea for Father's Day. In 1924, Father's Day got a little more credence, two thumbs up from Calvin Coolidge. And in 1966, President Lyndon Baines Johnson made a proclamation declaring Father's Day a special day. Father's Day became a national holiday in 1972 when it was signed into law by President Richard M. Nixon. Now, I personally, this is speaking over myself, this is one of those things, I think Father's Day, Mother's Day, Valentine's Day, these are to me more or less commercial holidays. Now, if these are your favorite holidays, I do apologize. But I don't think they stand up to the real holidays like Independence Day, Thanksgiving, Memorial Day, and National Donut Day, which was just a week ago last Friday. Father's Day, National Donut Day, no comparison. And Father's Day is a little bit of a conundrum for me, because though I have co-parented a child from their birth till they flew the coop, I share no genetic history with that child, and therefore I am neither their father nor their mother. That child, now an adult, during the time that we were raising them, I was presenting as male, and I assumed the role of dad in our family. And that is what my now adult child still calls me, is dad. And that is my choice entirely, because I am their dad. I lost my place, so I will tell you right here, because I wrote everything down, because I'm so smart. And dad is still the term my child uses for me today, and that is my choice. My child, for sure, would use another term if I wanted one, but I'm their dad. It's the single accomplishment that I'm the proudest of in my whole life. And no more proud was I than on the day when 8-year-old them stood in front of the family court judge and told them that they wanted to be make the adoption official, and I became dad. So dad it is. The language, that's our agreement. That's the agreement we have. The language that people use is important. How people are called, to be called by what you want. And I'm not talking about trans people, I'm talking about people. We all have things that we like to be called. We have our short names or our nicknames or our surnames or people have been changing their last names for marriage for years and changing their last names for divorce for years. It's nothing new. But for transgender folks and gender diverse folks, using the right pronouns and name could be the difference between having a really wonderful gender euphoric day in your own body and having a day where you feel like you have to close the world off and pull the covers over your head. It's important what we call people. I remember very well on my 50th birthday, I screwed up the courage to dress fully as myself, and I walked into the center in Hillcrest for the Monday Night Transgender Coming Out group. And it was run by a wonderful man named Gabriel, and there they asked me what my name was, and I told them it was Michelle at the time, Michelle, and they asked me my pronouns, and I said she, her, hers. And they used my name and my pronouns out loud. It was the first time in my life that I heard those words that I've been using for myself for so long out loud. And it was amazing. It was affirming. And I don't use this word very often, but it was empowering to have that. It just meant so much to me. Fast forward for 14 years exactly, less 2 weeks from that day. I stand here 5 years into my medical gender transition. I'm 4 years living as Gracie Soden. I came out on that wonderful year of 2020. And I've I'm working at the same job that I've had. I transitioned at work. I was the boss. It was hard. But right now, I've stepped down. I'm boxing groceries in the front end, which is the same job I started with 41 years ago when I was 23 years old. And I tell you, boxing groceries in this large wholesale club in town is a lot easier, in my memory, when I was 23 than it is. But I'm still really good at it. You come through my line with your disheveled basket, and I'll send it away beautifully. You know, I'm really good. Try me out. But when I was early in my transition, I was misgendered all the time. Every day, all the time. And it was really hard. It was hard to stay positive. It was hard to enjoy my day. It was hard to finish a shift, frankly. But today, I rarely misgendered. And that is just, it just feels so wonderful. Some days I don't even think about gender. Some days it feels like nothing. And why is nothing good? Because you have to think for somebody that for 5 decades before this, thought about gender every day, every minute, all the time. And the first time I didn't think about gender was just recently. And I assume that's probably what it's like for people, but it's the first time I experienced it, and it's gender euphoria for sure. Still, even now, there are some people that I love and who love me. There are my workmates, especially the ones that I've worked with for a long, long time, who sometimes get my pronouns wrong. And they correct themselves or they apologize and they go on and it's fine. I know who they are and how they are. It's just a mistake, it's fine. But at least 3 or 4 days a week, I will have some man, invariably a man so far, who is separated from their party, physically separated or by themselves, who at the completion of my boxing their order will say to me and only to me directly, "Thank you, sir," or "Thanks, bud," or "Call me guy." And that is intended to hurt. And it has. And this is the thing that I've been really working on. Like, I have spent so much time and emotional energy trying to understand, why would you do that? Why would you do that? What is the intention? Is it to say that you want me to know that you know that I'm one of them transgenders? Why? Is it because you're a bad person? Or is it because you think I'm a bad person? I've spent so much time trying to understand this because it's such a foreign idea to me to use language in that way. To use language to hurt somebody. I've never done that. Maybe it's because I'm transgender and I know that people are different and so I have this empathy naturally, but no. None of my friends would do that. I'm confident there's nobody in the room here that would do that. My assemblers wouldn't do that. Why would you? And there are people in public figures who are using degrading and belittling language and they have a following. Why? And it's not just the language. It's the actions. If you were driving down a residential street and it was kind of busy traffic and you saw a family that was trying to cross but there were too many cars coming and you could stop, you can't always stop, maybe you're in a hurry, maybe you're the last car and you just want to go by, there's plenty of reasons why you wouldn't, but let's say you could. Let's say you could stop for them. Why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you? That's what I can't figure out. I mean, let's say there was some crazy, nutty thing that never happens, like there's a global pandemic and you find out that wearing masks helps to save lives. And there's lots of reasons why you can wear masks. People don't wear masks, some people can't wear masks, that's fine, I understand. But if you could wear a mask, suppose you could do it, why wouldn't you? If you have a choice, why would you choose not to? Why would you? Recently, I traveled to Tucson, Arizona with my wife, who is, I will point out, always working behind the scenes and my champion entirely. And we ended up in a brew pub, which was owned by one of our high school classmates, that was hosting an event of graduates from this small high school in Tucson. So I ended up having a private conversation in this brew pub. You know how you can, there's people talking all around you, and you're just talking to one person, and there's really nobody listening to what you're talking to, so across the table from them. And I want to make sure that I'm framing this correctly. This person was a younger man, was affable, friendly, engaging, and we were having a wonderful conversation. At one point, he turned and he said to me, he says, "I'm looking at you, and I've got to tell you, I can't understand why would a man want to be a woman? I can't understand it, and there's nothing I can say," he said. "There's nothing I can say about it because I believe people should live free and do what they want to do. And I know you're doing that." But, and this is where the hand gestures came in. Man, woman. And I agreed with him. I said, "Yeah, that's my expectation. I think it would be really hard for somebody to understand that wasn't transgender. I think that would be a really hard thing to do. I think, but I, for me, it's just representing myself the way that I am for the first time in my life." He seemed to take that, and it seemed like a positive response, but his next follow-up question was, "But why are you always trying to push your language on us? Why should you tell me how I should call somebody? Why are you forcing us to do this?" And I've never been confronted with this before. "I don't know much. I just know me." I said, I've never forced my language on anybody. I never have. I've never had to. I have occasionally requested it of people that they use the proper language, but I never forced it on anyone. But when people do use my name, and they do use my pronouns, I appreciate it so much. It's such a nice thing to do for someone. And if you could do a nice thing, wouldn't you want to do it? For some reason, I don't know why, it seemed to hit home with him. And he thanked me profusely for explaining that and staying in there and having this discussion and not being upset. And he hung around with me for the rest of the night. Where I went, he was just right there next to me. This fellow was engaging, and several bully pops in. I was thinking, this is, you know, a really win. Maybe I have a way that I can talk to my workplace tormentors to make them understand. But, you know, as time went on, I thought, no, I don't know. I have no idea whether I made an impact. You know what? It doesn't make a difference. Because I took two things from that conversation. One, I realized how incredibly lucky I am to have surrounded myself with people who would, after I just told them why I was doing what I was doing, what I was doing, and what my name was, they did the rest. They've done the rest. They've policed themselves. They did that for me. That's a respect. It's love. It's the difference between calling someone by their name or name calling. It's the difference between my child calling me dad and this fellow calling me sir. It's the respect of it. The second thing that I took away is these men don't know anything about me. And this isn't about me. It's some idea they have. They don't know what it was like to have a longing for your whole life. They don't know what it was like to always keep secrets. They don't know what it's like to self-medicate with drugs and alcohol to get by. They don't know what it's like to always wonder if the people who like you would still like you if they knew who you were. They don't know what it's like to be that lonely. And they don't have to. It's like, I don't need to know anything about them. But I don't need to know anything about them to treat them with respect and dignity by simple fact that they're humans. They're humanity. And it's that way with all my friends, all the people in my life. In fact, Sunday Assembly people I've seen go out of their way to make people comfortable. They don't do the basics, they do the extra. We always have a motto when we go someplace, try to leave it better than when we came. And we've really, really strived to do that. And that's what they do. So, I know who these guys are. And I know how they are. And the next time one of those guys comes through my line, I'm going to take all their groceries, I'm going to take all their heavy items, I'm going to put them in their basket, and I'm going to put their box on top, I'm going to put all the frozen things in the box, I'll separate from the chemicals, and I'm going to make another box that has just the produce in it, and I'm going to put their eggs and their bread and their strawberries on the top. Because that's how I am. And I realize, this happens 3 or 4 times a week. I see about 5,000 people a week. These people are outliers. They're outliers. And they're people who have shut themselves off from having community with lovely groups of people all over the world. And that's just sad. If any of you want to wish me a happy Father's Day today, please do. I will take it as ironic and lovely. Thank you very much. We will take a moment of silent reflection. Let me tell you a little bit about what's coming up with Sunday Assembly. We're doing a summer solstice party. We do a summer solstice. It's pretty close to solstice. It's going to be the 23rd, I believe, is the date. Am I wrong about that? It's right there. Let's see, 22nd. So from 5 to 8, that's going to be in Chula Vista in a private family's backyard. We just had a rock painting event there the other day that was just lovely. Please do come. It'll be super fun. Just RSVP on Meetup, please. And it's just a lovely time. We have here at the venue fireworks here, and you can see all San Diego Bay. We have the most magnificent view of the entire bay, and I think there are 60 spaces, and I believe there's only 2 left, is that correct, or is it all taken?
I think it's 3.
3 left. 3 spaces left, so if you want to get on Meetup right now and reserve yourself a spot, we have pizza and stuff here, and you just hang out and talk and play games and watch all the fireworks all at once. It's just really, really terrific. So, July 20th, what have you got on your bucket list? Walking in the parade in front of 300,000 people, smiling and waving? Put that on there, because this is an opportunity for you to walk with us. Sunday Assembly this year, we had a really nice NPR article. It was on All Things Considered, I believe. It was 5 minutes. It was a woman from Sunday Assembly from Detroit. There's 20-something Sunday Assemblies in the United States, 9 in California. And she just really spelled out what Sunday Assembly is. And we've got a little foothold that people are trying to understand Sunday Assembly in the community. And so this year, we really want to have a good contingent of people that will march with us. And if you have a really good showing, and wave to all those people. So if you can consider that, if you don't want to march, we're going to make it as easy as possible. Parking's right here. We're going to show you up to the top. You're going to walk back down. You're going to walk the 4 blocks back over here, right back to your car. Super easy. 4 hours-ish tops. Shouldn't be bad. I know that is way, way long, but I really, really would love to have your help. And if you can't help, please let someone else know there's this opportunity. And if you don't want to march, there's all of the ways to help any shuttle drivers, any people at the festival, and some other things. So please, please do consider it. Lastly, I am going to bring up Lynn Warner to talk about grief counseling support systems. Okay.
Today, right after, well, maybe about 15 minutes after the assembly ends, anybody who's interested in participating in a discussion group that will focus on issues related to grief and loss, please come into the playroom, like I said, about 15 minutes after we end, so that I can find out how many people may be interested, what kind of day of the week, time of day, that sort of thing. This was actually something recommended by someone who attends some of our events, and it's something that he felt a need for. And so it's not going to be a counseling event. Even though I'm not a mental health professional, I'll just be there as a volunteer, sort of facilitating discussion. So anyway, meet me in the playroom afterwards. Thanks.
Thank you, Lynn. Lynn is a board member for San Diego Assembly and a clinical psychologist, and we're so happy to have her join this group. Let's do a little wave to the Zoomlers or Roomlers. So good to see people on Zoom. 43rd time we're doing that. We did that all through the pandemic. We only missed one assembly all the way through the pandemic. We were always on the lookout for excellent speakers and topics and to host personal stories to share. So if you have any of that, just talk to anyone you saw up here today. And we're all volunteers here and dependent on donations to keep this community going. Please consider a cash donation in one of the jars or use the QR code on your program or screen behind me to set up a one-time or even better, a monthly recurring donation, which allows the finance committee to plan a budget. We are serious when we say every penny matters. Thank you all for all of you who are our current donors. This community would not exist if it wasn't without you. I'm reading that verbatim. There's lots more that I put in here, but really, people work so hard. We have 11 people on our board. It's the largest board for any Sunday assembly. We've been doing this for 11 years now, and there's a cost to it. It's almost $800 to rent this place for just the few hours that we do, so we can really use your help. You know what we can use help with is singing along with Paul and Dan. All we need is love.
I think we should stand for this one. As a matter of fact, I will stand for this one. All right. Here we go.
Love, 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 love
behind your chat and answer your questions. And there are snacks and coffee, so stick around. Thank you all so much for being here today.